Psalm 72. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to a king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. May the mountains yield prosperity for the people and the hills in righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor. May he live while the sun endures and as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on the mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound until the moon is no more. May all kings fall down before him, all nations give him service, for he delivers the needy when they call, the poor and those who have no helper. He has pity on the weak and the needy, and saves the lives of the needy. From oppression and violence he redeems their life, and precious is their blood in his sight. May his name endure forever, his fame continue as long as the sun. Blessed be the glorious name of the Lord forever. May his glory fill the whole earth. Amen. And amen. Good morning, College Mennonite Church. Feliz Año Nuevo. Happy New Year. It's good to have you here with us in this space, and those of you watching at home taking advantage of the use of technology on this snowy and icy morning here in northern Indiana. We are, again, still in the Christmas season. This is Epiphany Sunday. And we are still celebrating the gift of God coming to us in human form, God incarnate, God acting with empathy for the world. Would you please join me in the call to worship? God's light has come to reveal the way in this new year. Arise, shine, levántate, resplandece. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. Arise, shine, levántate, resplandece. God's light penetrates the darkness that covers the world. Arise, shine, levántate, resplandece. Nations shall come to God's light and kings to the brightness of God's dawn. Arise, shine, levántate, resplandece, for the glory of the Lord has risen upon us. I invite you to stand if you are able, and let's sing together in Voices Together, number 276, Solemn Stillness, Weary Streets.
Thank you. Join me in prayer. God, long ago, you set a star blazing in the sky to announce to the world that the Messiah was born. That star of hope still shines, still lights the way for us in the shadow times and in the dazzling times. On this first Sunday of a new year, hear these prayers of your people. God, we pray for your good creation. You created a world of plenty. We pray that you will give us the wisdom and the courage to use only our share of resources, to live in community and wholeness with all of your vast creation. We pray for the well-being of all nations and all peoples. We pray that your justice will prevail. Reveal to us the role that you are calling us to play in healing and peace. God, we pray for those who grieve, for those who grieve the death of loved ones, especially for the family and friends of Elaine Schrock and Brent Blau. We miss these dear ones in our midst. We also lift to you those who grieve other losses in life. And God, we pray for those who struggle with health, for Geneva Stoltzfus, Naomi Jancy, Wanda Newbury, the Torres Mendez family, the Mel family, and Ijinito Luna. We pray for those who deal with ongoing health struggles, the kind that are just part of life, but still tax that daily life. We pray that you will give all those who struggle with illness and those who care for them strength and patience. We pray also for the many who are affected in so many ways by COVID-19. We pray for the health system as it struggles to provide care for all patients, for those who are trying to make wise decisions in the face of a new variant. And God, we lift to you those who struggle with mental illness and those who are close to them. Give them hope. Help us to reach out to be a community that surrounds them. We pray today for those who are fleeing violence and persecution and hopeless situations, especially for those who are finding their way here to our church community. Show us the way to welcome, to open our doors, to share our resources, to be family to these travelers. We have many unspoken prayers, Lord. Hear those. God, I pray that you will place that star of hope in front of us. Place it right there so we can't miss it as we move into a new year together, a new year full of new joys, of new challenges. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite families to come forward now and families to gather close to your screens at home as we sing together number 239 in Voices Together, He Came Down. Finished passing, whoops, missed one there. There we go. Got a few things for each of you here. Zeph, let's share some of yours, okay? Here, this one, and this one, and this one, maybe. All right. There we go. Now, hold on to those for just a moment. I got to go and visit the newest born friend in our congregation just a couple weeks ago. Her name is Baby Lucy, and she is so soft and so sweet, and she's full of smiles, and it was so fun to visit her and hold her. I got to visit quite a few of you when you were born, too. I remember going to see Mara for the first time. I remember coming to see both Max and Micah when they were born. Some of you, I didn't get to come visit when you were born because maybe you weren't here in this congregation quite yet. I remember visiting Caleb when he was born. But Matthew, I met you when you were a couple of weeks old, the first time your parents brought you here. And Jasmine and Miles, you were a little older the first time I met you. Zeph, I met you pretty quickly after you were born. You are about the same age, that's true. Yeah, there, some of the children who were born right around the same time as Zeph, I didn't meet until they were a little older. I was on maternity leave, yeah. And I remember people visiting when my kids were born. Pastor Pamela came and visited Zeph in the hospital, I remember. And some of the rest of you came to visit our kiddos when they were born. A lot of times when babies are born, people come and visit them. And part of that is because many of us really like to meet and hold new babies. They are kind of full of hope. And it's also a way that we help parents know that they're not alone, that they have a whole community that's surrounding them and helping them as this baby grows and all the challenges that happen as our babies grow bigger. Now, Jesus had some visitors, too. We've got a little baby Jesus here. Think back to the Christmas pageant. Who came to visit baby Jesus? Yeah, Zeph?
The shepherds.
Shepherds came first, right? Okay, look in, we'll get to that in just a moment there, Miles. Look at the figures that you have with you. Are any of them, do you think any of them might be shepherds?
Oh,
a sheep. Yes, we think maybe some sheep might have come along with the shepherds, right? And maybe a sheepdog. Okay, so if you have shepherds, bring them up to the baby. Okay, let them come visit that baby Jesus. I think your other one is a shepherd there, Caleb. Yeah, I think that one is. Some of them, it's kind of hard to tell with some of these. Good, and those shepherds, we think they probably were Jewish, like Jesus and his family would have been. They probably felt fairly familiar to Mary and Joseph, even if they didn't already know them. Kind of like, you don't necessarily know the names of everyone in your church family, but they feel kind of familiar to you. And then there was another whole group that in the Christmas pageant came up to visit Jesus right around offering time. Yeah, sometimes we call them the kings or the magi or the wise men. If you have one of those, bring them up. That's all the rest of them, by the way. All right, so we don't really have a great English word for what these were. Sometimes we call them those three ones I'd already mentioned, but wise people maybe is a good way to say it. They were astrologers, we think. And we think they were probably from somewhere in Persia. We know where they were, east of where Jesus was born. But we don't know a whole lot about them. We do know that they most likely were not Jewish. So coming from farther away and being of a different group of people than Mary and Joseph and Jesus were, they would have felt a little different to them, right? And so Jesus had visitors who felt very similar to his family and visitors who felt very different and traveled really far to visit him. And even though Jesus' many visitors were not all alike, they were all welcome there with Jesus. The Bible over and over and over says that we are to welcome the stranger. And Mary and Joseph and even baby Jesus did that from the get-go, didn't they? And all of those visitors, all of these visitors, were children of God. Let's pray together. God, thank you for sending Jesus, who even as a baby was full of surprises. Thank you for this big family of yours, this family that is bigger and more diverse than even our imaginations. Thank you that all of us are welcome with Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, you may go back to your seats.
Our preacher for today is David Maldonado. Please join me in a prayer of blessing for David and for us in this time. God of light, we thank you for David and for the many ways that he has seen, responded to, and lived the way of Jesus in this world. May the words of David's mouth and the meditations of our hearts grow into new possibilities for your love to shine in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. And Happy New Year's. I wish you a blessed year. We don't know what we're going to get this year, do we? And I don't think anybody even imagined that this COVID business would last this long. But this morning I want to talk on this little phrase, open to possibilities, that you and I, this year, we stay open to a thought I want to share with you this morning. I'll be reading in the book of Matthew, chapter 2, from verse 1 to verse 12. I like to use the NIV, so that's the version I'm reading from. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Now I'm going to just set that story to the side for a minute. And I'm going to share something with you that seems completely unrelated here. But give me a chance here. As I thought about open to possibilities, I came upon this thing called theoretical perspective. So I'm going to read what I found about this. Theoretical perspective is important for research because it serves to organize thoughts and ideas and make them clear to others. Often, multiple theoretical perspectives are used simultaneously to frame research questions, design, and conduct research and analyze results. A theoretical definition defines a term in an academic discipline, functioning as a proposal to see a phenomenon in a certain way. Theoretical definitions contain built-in theories. They cannot be simply reduced to describing a set of observations. The definition of theoretical is something that is based on an assumption or an opinion. And then, thank be to God and the author of that definition, they put in an example. An example of theoretical is lower interest rates will boost the housing market. So there's this perspective, this way of thinking that certain disciplines, physicists, scientists, archaeologists, and a slew of other disciplines, they allow themselves to think this way. They have their data, they have historical data, they are studied in their discipline. They're not being foolish, not at all. This isn't superfluous or just imagining things. But based on the data they have, based on their experience, based on their studies, they allow themselves to think outside those parameters, if you will. They're open to possibilities. And by being open to possibility, it allows them to go on these paths of research. And oftentimes, because this occurs throughout the world in these disciplines, we then, humans, get to enjoy their discoveries. Are you with me? Please say yes so I don't have to start over. There you go. Thank you. Then I got to thinking. Yearly, the church throughout the world thinks about this verse or these verses, this visitation, these folks coming from the east, presenting themselves to King Herod and sharing with King Herod their experience, what they're looking for. King Herod goes, "What is going on?" We understand he's feeling threatened by this statement. He's threatened by just about anybody who surrounds him, no? He's paranoid or something's wrong with the man. And these folks go on their journey and they go to visit this child. And I also imagine that for the mother, Mary, and Joseph, it's also a surprise. I mean, how did these people know? You know, we don't have cell phones, we don't have Zoom, they didn't have the technology we have. So they're surprised by it. So here we are in the year 2022, give or take, depending on who you speak with, 2,000 years ago or a little bit less, whatever. But here we are, considering this story, making memory of this story, we are commemorating this event. And therein lies what we call Epiphany, right? So year after year, this happens. And we think about the event. But it's a memory. It's historical. A memory is a historical event, something that already occurred. It is frozen in time. It is captive in your soul. It lives inside of you, and every now and then it surfaces. And oftentimes, some memories are so powerful that when that memory surfaces, you can hear, you can relive that moment. But I would like us to go beyond the memory. I would like us to take upon ourselves this theoretical perspective, attitude, or mindset. To be open, to go beyond the memory. So I want to propose the following. Because I find that it's ironic that the sciences and certain disciplines are open to the possibility of something new coming out of something that we already know. So they stay open to this possibility. We know what we're working with. We respect the laws we work with. We use observations and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we're open to the possibility that we may discover something new. We may experience something that we have yet to experience. So I propose that we do the same. That we stay open to the possibility that having all this historical data, which I'm going to confine to and refer to the Bible, that maybe there are still, or maybe there is still the possibility that there may be a divine manifestation. That it is possible that tomorrow when you wake up, and you're preparing your tea or your coffee, and I don't know if you like tea biscuits or whatever you enjoy, that you're dipping your tea biscuits in, oh my Lord, who is that sitting across the table from me? Is it even possible? What if we applied theoretical perspective to the church settings? Would that allow a manifestation of the divine? I know this is just me thinking, and I'm sharing my thoughts with you. So, allow me to press inward a little more. Would a manifestation of the divine deepen your understanding and your faith? If Christ, who is no longer a baby, if Christ were to manifest himself to you, would that help your thoughts go deeper? Would that enlighten you? Would that liberate you? Would that help what you call faith? How would a manifestation of the supernatural impact you? I have thought about this for me. I have no idea how it would impact me, but I got a feeling that it would really benefit me and help me change more. I think it would help me become more like Matthew chapter 5, 6, 7, and 8. I think it would empower me more to be that child, that son of God, that makes God smile or grin. Maybe the question is, would you be interested in such a thing? Have you even thought about it? Of having a conversation with the one you've been singing to for so long. Like, where are you at? Show up. Quit hiding, the prophet Isaiah said. For you are one who loves to hide. It's like he loves to play hide and seek, but he's the one who's always hiding. And we're always seeking. In closing, I want you to think about this stuff. I want you to think about theoretical perspectives and how these disciplines allow themselves to think in this way. And do we allow ourselves to think this way? Are we open to the possibilities of a divine manifestation? I want to close reading Psalm chapter 8, verse 4. What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? And I ask this, who are you? Who are you that the Lord of hosts longs to visit you? Thank you.
Thank you.
When we give our best to God, God uses it to open up new possibilities for ourselves and for other people. So I invite you now to bring your tithes and offerings forward as a offering of your best to God. And I encourage you to find unique moments this week to give an offering of love to someone around you. We will sing our offertory song this morning, so I invite you to turn in Voices Together again to number 274, See Whose Glory Fills the Skies, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. So please, let's sing and bring your tithes and offerings forward with a glad and joyful heart.
Prayer of thanksgiving. Father, thank you for your love, your compassion, your mercies. Thank you for your provision. And we place these offerings, these tithes, in your hands for this work And we thank you for everyone who gives of the abundance you give to them. In Christ's name, we thank you. Amen. Join us, O beautiful star of Bethlehem. Voices Together, number 275. And stand, if you will.
Since there's no Sunday school today, this will be a great opportunity to join the bilingual service at 11:11 this morning. So I invite you to stick around for that. But as you go into this week and into this new year, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to God in heaven. Go in peace.